Hi everybody. In the past couple of videos, we've talked about the transfer of energy through heat and work, and the first law of thermodynamics. In the next few videos, we're going to move to the other concept that determines whether chemical processes happen spontaneously, and that's entropy. This video will be a sort of conceptual introduction to entropy, and then we'll move on in future videos to the second and third laws of thermodynamics. So why is it that certain chemical processes happen spontaneously? Your first instinct might be that things happen spontaneously to make the energy of a system lower. For example, bonds tend to form spontaneously, or electrons tend to spontaneously move down to their electronic ground state. This idea is appealing because it's analogous to what happens in classical mechanics. For example, in classical mechanics, a ball tends to roll downhill in order to lower its gravitational potential energy. We've also seen in our coverage of statistical mechanics that this idea has some grounding at the quantum level. For example, Boltzmann factors tell us that lower energy states are more likely to be occupied. So there is some truth to this idea that energy spontaneously tends to get lower. But that's not the whole story, as illustrated by some counterexamples. For example, when you put ideal gases into a container, they spontaneously tend to expand and mix. But because attractive and repulsive forces can be ignored in ideal gases, this expanding and mixing is not due to any lowering of energy, so there must be something else going on. A more obvious example, but still an important one, is that ice spontaneously melts above its melting point of 0 degrees Celsius. So even though melting is an endothermic process, it does happen spontaneously at some temperatures. As these counterexamples illustrate, and as we'll see throughout the next few videos, it turns out that both energy and entropy matter in determining whether a process happens spontaneously. To understand why entropy matters, let's look at a macroscopic analogy. Imagine a box that has two compartments, a left side and a right side, and there are 6 objects in that box that are flying around randomly. At any moment in time, each object is either on the left side or on the right side. And any possible arrangement of those 6 objects has the same energy. No one snapshot is any more or less stable than any other snapshot, just as in an ideal gas. So the arrangements in these 2 pictures, one of which has all 6 objects on the left, and the other of which has 3 on the left and 3 on the right, these are both equally stable in terms of energy. So the question I have for you is, at any point in time, is it more likely that you're going to see all 6 objects on the left, or that you'll see 3 on the left and 3 on the right? I'll give you a few seconds to think about that. It turns out that you're more likely to see 3 objects on the left and 3 objects on the right than you are to see all 6 objects on the left. And the reason for that is that there are just more ways for it to happen. In order for all 6 objects to be on the left, there's really only one thing that can happen. Independently, each of those 6 objects happens to be on the left side. But there are many different ways that you can end up with 3 objects on the left and 3 on the right. In the picture, the red, green, and purple objects are all on the left. But you can imagine another situation in which the green, blue, and orange objects are on the left, or the purple, red, and blue objects are on the left, and there are many different ways that you could reach this 3-3 split. Let's start to talk about this in the language of entropy. When a system is more disordered, in other words, when the objects occupy a mixture of different states, there are more individual arrangements, and we're going to call those individual arrangements microstates, that lead to the same observed property, and we're going to call the observed property the macrostate. So in this case, if you look at the picture on the right, the microstate is that the red, green, and purple objects are on the left, and the black, blue, and orange objects are on the right. And the macrostate is that 3 objects are on the left, and 3 objects are on the right. So there are many individual microstates that lead to that 3-3 split, the macrostate. So that means the macrostate that involves the 3-3 split is more probable than the macrostate in which all 6 objects are on the left, even though any individual microstate has the same energy. Let's stick with this macroscopic example and put some numbers to it. The first numerical question I have for you is, if you have these six objects where each one is either on the left side or the right side of the box, how many total microstates are there? In other words, how many unique ways can you put those six objects in those two sides of the box? I'll give you a few seconds to think about it. The total number of microstates is 2 to the 6th power, or 64. The idea is that each of those six particles can be on either the left side or the right side. So each particle has two possibilities, and so the total number of possibilities is the 2 for the first particle times the 2 for the second particle times the 2 for the third particle, etc. Each particle independently can be in one of those two sides, so the total number is 2 to the 6th. Those 64 microstates can fall into a number of different macrostates, in which there are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6 objects on the left side, and all of the remaining objects are on the right. So I'd like you to take some time to think about how many of these 64 microstates lead to each of these 7 macrostates. I would suggest hitting pause and taking some time to think about it. Well, in some cases, it's fairly easy to figure out. For example, for the macro state in which there are 0 objects on the left, really the only way for that to happen is if independently each of those 6 objects is on the right. So that's only one microstate that leads to 0 objects on the left. Similarly, there's only one microstate that leads to all 6 objects on the left. That's just the reflection of the case that we just talked about. We can also fairly easily count the case in which there's one object on the left. That one object on the left can be any of the 6 unique colors. So there's 6 microstates that lead to one object on the left, and similarly, there are another 6 microstates that lead to 5 objects on the left and one object on the right. Things get a little bit harder to count as there's more mixing on the two sides. If there are 2 objects on the left, one way to think about it is that there are 6 choices for the first object and 5 choices for the second object. So that sounds like there might be 30 different ways to have 2 objects on the left until you realize that order doesn't matter. In other words, blue-red is the same as red-blue. So we're going to take that 30 and divide by 2 and see that there are actually only 15 unique ways to have 2 objects on the left. Similarly, there are another 15 microstates that have 4 objects on the left and 2 objects on the right. If we wanted to, we could count out the possibilities for 3 objects on the left and 3 on the right, or we could just realize that all of the possibilities that we haven't accounted for already have to have 3 on the left and 3 on the right. So, if we write out the numbers, it looks like this, and if you add all of those numbers together, all of the microstates that lead to each macrostate, they add up to the total 64 microstates that we knew that we had. What's more important than the specific numbers for this case is knowing a general formula for finding number of microstates. And the general formula is this. We're going to use the letter capital W to represent number of microstates. And if you have capital N particles, of which there are N1 particles in state 1 and N2 particles in state 2, then the number of microstates is N factorial over N1 factorial times N2 factorial. Remember that factorial is the product of all positive integers up to a certain number. For example, 3 factorial is 1 times 2 times 3. So if, for example, we're looking at the case in which there are 6 total objects and 2 are on the left and 4 are on the right, the number of microstates leading to that macrostate is 6 factorial divided by 2 factorial times 4 factorial, which, as we already saw, turns out to be 15. You may have already seen this formula in the past if you've ever looked at combinations in a math class. We would call a function like this 6choose2, where you have 6 objects and you're looking for the number of unique ways to choose 2 of them. That choose function has the same formula shown on the slide. And just as a side note, as sort of a mathematical piece of trivia, the series of numbers shown on this slide is actually a row of Pascal's triangle, which is a triangle that you can generate by setting each number equal to the sum of the two above it. That's not particularly important to us going forward, but it's kind of a fun mathematical fact. we're not always going to be looking at cases where there are only two possible states. We may have a larger number of possibilities. For example, a case like the one shown in this slide, where each object can be in one of four possible states. So if we have four degenerate energy states like this, we may want to know how many microstates lead to a macrostate like the one shown on the slide, where there are four particles in the first state, three particles in the third state, and two particles in the fourth state. It turns out that if we want to find the number of microstates that lead to this macrostate, there's a formula similar to the one that we saw on the last slide. The number of microstates is going to be the total number of particles factorial divided by the product of the number of particles in each of the states factorial. So in this case, 9 factorial divided by 4 factorial times 0 factorial times 3 factorial times 2 factorial, remembering that 0 factorial is equal to 1. So in this case, there are a very large number of microstates leading to this macrostate, 1,260. And the general formula for this is what it looks like. The number of microstates is equal to the number of particles factorial divided by the number of particles in each one of the individual states factorial multiplied together. So what does all of this have to do with entropy? This is Ludwig Boltzmann's gravesite. In addition to being able to see that he was a fairly serious person, you can also see that there's an equation here. And if you want there to be an equation on your gravestone, you must think that equation is pretty important. This equation says S equals K log W. S is entropy, K is what we typically call KB, the Boltzmann constant, log is what we would typically call the natural log, ln, and W is the number of microstates. So you'll more commonly see this equation written as S equals KB ln W. And this equation is what connects the number of microstates, which we've been talking about for the past few slides, to entropy, which is going to be the topic of the next several videos. This equation is known as the Boltzmann entropy formula, and we're not actually going to derive it, but we will try to make some sense of it. First of all, this equation suggests that a larger number of microstates, a larger W, relates to a larger entropy, a larger S. This kind of makes sense. When you first learn about entropy in general chemistry, you're taught to think about it as disorder. And as we saw in our example where there were objects on two sides of a box, the macrostates that were more disordered, in other words, the macrostates that had objects on both sides of the container, were the ones that had more microstates associated with them. The Boltzmann entropy formula tells us that that relationship between entropy and microstates turns out to be logarithmic. Entropy equals KB times the natural log of the number of microstates. Again, we're not going to derive this, but I do want to mention a couple of implications of it. First of all, this equation suggests that it's possible in principle to have zero entropy. If a system is perfectly ordered, in other words, if it has just one microstate, then because the natural log of 1 equals 0, there would be zero entropy. This is an idea that we'll revisit later on when we talk about the third law of thermodynamics. Another thing to notice is that this equation correctly makes entropy an extensive property. In other words, if we have a system AB that consists of two separate parts, A and B, the number of microstates in the entire system would be the product of the number of microstates in part A times the number of microstates in part B. Thinking back to our log rules, we know that the natural log of the product of two numbers is the sum of those two natural logs. That means if we have a product of microstates, it leads to a sum of entropies. And as we'll see later on, it is true that you can add together the entropies of two parts of a system to get a total entropy. Although this equation is fundamentally interesting, it's not all that usable, because the number of microstates isn't always something that we can easily find. So the Boltzmann entropy formula would be more useful if, rather than microstates, it was posed in terms of something that we could more easily find. And as has often been the case in our coverage of statistical mechanics, that's going to be the partition function. It turns out that we can find the entropy of a system in terms of the partition function. We could go through this derivation, it is in the textbook, but we're not going to do it here. I'll instead show you the result. We can say that the entropy of a system is equal to the energy of the system divided by temperature plus the Boltzmann constant times the natural log of the partition function, capital Q. So all of that work that we've done in past videos to find the partition function for various types of systems will now come in handy because it allows us to find the entropy. Let's look at a concrete example of how this plays out for a simple system. Imagine we have capital N distinguishable atoms in a crystal, and that each of those atoms has two possible spins. Every atom is either spin up or spin down. Assume that the energy of any combination of spins is equally stable and can be defined as zero. So as this picture shows, you could have some random arrangement of spin up and spin down atoms, and any arrangement would be as energetically stable as any other. So the questions we can answer here are, first of all, what is the partition function of this system? What is capital Q? And second of all, what is the entropy, capital S, of the system? To find the partition function, let's first think about a single atom within this system. Each atom can either be spin up or spin down, and both of those possibilities have energy zero. That means we have two degenerate ground states, each of which has energy zero and therefore a Boltzmann factor of 1. The partition function for a single atom is then the sum of those two Boltzmann factors, which would be 2. And because these atoms are distinguishable, the partition function capital Q for the whole system is going to be lowercase q, which we said is 2, raised to the power of the number of atoms, which is capital N. So, the partition function equals 2 to the power n. And to find the entropy of the system, we can plug that into the equation at the top of the slide. Because we said that the energy is always 0, we can ignore the first term and say that the entropy is kb times the natural log of q. So that's kb times the natural log of 2 to the n. And according to our log rules, we can take that capital N and move it out front. So the entropy is capital N, the number of atoms, times the Boltzmann constant, times the natural log of 2. So essentially, each atom is contributing a really tiny amount of entropy, kb times the natural log of 2, and that entropy is added together over all of the atoms in the system. I'll end the video with a couple of takeaway messages. Whether a chemical process is spontaneous depends on a combination of factors. First of all, energy tends to decrease. In other words, bonds tend to form and systems tend to move toward their energetic ground states. Also, entropy tends to increase. Systems move toward more disordered states, in which there are more ways of achieving a given observed property. We also saw that the relationship between entropy and the number of microstates is logarithmic, and it's governed by the Boltzmann entropy formula, which is entropy equals Boltzmann constant times the natural log of the number of microstates. That's all for now. This video has been kind of a conceptual introduction to entropy at the single particle level, and in the next few videos, we'll move toward a more macroscopic view of entropy as we introduce the second and third laws of thermodynamics.